Funding for this national BLET educational presentation has been provided by the North American Railway Foundation. NARF is a nonprofit operating foundation that was formed and funded by the Brotherhood's Relief and Compensation Fund to support rail history, education, safety, and technology in the United States and Canada. With continued Board of Directors stewardship coming from the BR and CF, NARF has supported many worthwhile projects over its 16-year history. The primary focus of these efforts has been in support of organized rail labor, giving back to all of the men and women of the railroad community across North America.
I'm Dennis Pierce, National President of the Brotherhood of Locomotive Engineers and Trainmen, which is a division of the Teamsters Rail Conference. The video you're about to see was produced as part of our commemoration of the 150th anniversary of the BLET's founding on May 8, 1863. It is the history of how the railroad industry built a nation and the role that the men and women of our union played in making America what it is today. It is a story that is long overdue to be told and contains the lessons of yesterday that provide a path for tomorrow.
Before there was a railroad, America moved at the speed of a horse. Population centers hugged the East Coast. Western lands were distant and dangerous. Goods and people moved along the nation's inland waterways, but very slowly and in small quantities. Vast lands went undeveloped. Valuable mineral and agricultural resources were untapped. Travel from New York to California took 3 months, by ship around the dangerous Cape Horn, or through Panama, where malaria claimed many lives. America's destiny was nothing more than a dream. The railroad changed all that. In the late 1820s, after successful tests of the new steam locomotive, railroads sprung up all along the East Coast. For hauling goods and transporting people, the steam locomotive had no peer. But the country was slow to embrace the new technology. Concerns about the safety of pressurized steam boilers, collisions, and other dangers were well founded. Only the bravest of men dared to grab the reins of the iron horse. These were the locomotive engineers.
In the early days, being a locomotive engineer was a perilous occupation. Derailments, train wrecks, and boiler explosions were commonplace. Early locomotives had open cabs, exposing engineers to severe weather conditions. A bumpy, jolting ride over uneven rails made running a train a dirty and extremely difficult and dangerous task.
The first engineers were poorly paid. They were sent out on runs for days at a time with little chance to sleep. At the other end of the line, they paid for their own food, lodging, and other costs. Compensated only for miles run, a railroad engineer worked for nothing while cleaning and maintaining his locomotive when the train was stopped, a dangerous task in itself, or while being assembled in a storage yard. Safety and sound engineering practices couldn't keep up with the explosion of new railroads, fresh track, and advances in technology. Nor was the government prepared to hop on board with regulations to improve safety, protect the public, or ease the plight of the engineer. That wouldn't happen for another half century. In spite of these hardships, the engineer welcomed the challenges that came with blazing new trails, and they were dedicated to their jobs. But back then, the railroads too often were not dedicated to the engineers. Livelihoods were regularly wiped out at the whim of a company official, or through bankruptcy or merger.
Engineers knew no fear, but they knew what was fair. In 1854, 16 Baltimore and Ohio engineers went on strike for better working conditions. Their demands were rejected, and the engineers were fired and replaced with inexperienced men, which led to a rash of avoidable accidents.
In response, engineers from 45 railroads gathered in Baltimore and formed an organization to protect railroad workers from abusive practices. Momentum was building towards the unionization of locomotive engineers. But civil war broke out, and engineers found themselves at the center of a different struggle, moving men and armaments into the heat of battle, changing the way wars would be fought forever. Then in 1862, another conflict changed the way workers would fight for their rights forever. When the management of the Michigan Central nullified a pay raise given to engineers and firemen by changing the runs, the workers rose up in protest. Many were fired. Engineers refused to go out on runs where the firemen were dismissed. And the movement to organize reached critical mass.
13 Michigan Central engineers met at the home of William D. Robinson in Marshall, Michigan. They agreed that if another engineer or fireman was dismissed without just cause, they would all quit work. Word about the meeting spread quickly and other engineers joined the movement. Soon after, a group of engineers met with Michigan Central management to address their grievances. And under pressure from the engineers, management agreed to their terms.
Spurred on by this victory, the movement extended to workers on more railroads. And in the spring of 1863, delegates from five railroads in and around Michigan met in Detroit to form the Pioneer Division of the Brotherhood of the Footboard, renamed the following year to the Brotherhood of Locomotive Engineers.
The BLE was created to represent locomotive engineers in our struggle to achieve fair pay and better working conditions.
The BLE grew quickly. 54 divisions were chartered in the first year, 172 within a decade. The first Canadian division was organized in Toronto in 1870. And by the early 1900s, the Brotherhood had expanded to Mexico and the Panama Canal Zone. One of the union's first acts was to establish an insurance association for BLE members, because insurance companies refused to cover engineers due to the extra hazardous nature of their work. For the next 150 years and beyond, the Brotherhood would meet every challenge it faced with the courage and bravery of each of its members and continue the struggle. The rapid growth of the Brotherhood of Locomotive Engineers paralleled massive expansion in railroad construction. By the 1840s, railroads had gained acceptance in America. Trains traveled between Chicago and New York in just 2 days. With deeds to government land grants in their back pockets, the railroads pushed west toward the Pacific. And in 1869, the Central Pacific and Union Pacific Railroads were joined by the Golden Spike at Promontory Point, Utah, forming the first transcontinental railroad.
Hundreds of new companies were chartered, and competition for new track was intense. Speculation led to unethical business practices and neglect for the engineers' safety and security. Stock manipulation and overextension of certain railroads took them into unprofitable territories. At the same time, the U.S. economy collapsed and millions of workers lost their jobs.
Strikes and labor unrest were rampant throughout this period. Two railroad strikes in particular would have tragic yet historic consequences. In 1877, a strike began in Martinsburg, West Virginia, then spread like wildfire to engulf the entire Northeast. Federal troops were called in to suppress the strikers with orders to shoot the strike to pieces, and that they did. By the time President Hayes declared martial law to force the engineers back to work, more than 100 workers had been killed. But the Brotherhood continued the struggle. A decade later, engineers and firemen began a 10-month strike when the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy violated seniority agreements and began dismissing workers without just cause. The railroad hired gangs of thugs and Pinkerton detectives with repeating rifles to intimidate, injure, and even murder the strikers. BLE Division 62 was broken financially. All its striking members were fired and blacklisted from the industry for life. And still, the Brotherhood continued the struggle. This was the management style of a handful of tycoons who rose to fame and fortune on the backs of the railroad workers. Robber barons disregarded public safety in the name of profits. They paid starvation wages and crushed competition to create monopolies that could keep prices high and wages low. And still, the Brotherhood continued the struggle.
We had some rough times back then, but there was a lot to be optimistic about, too. When our delegates convened in Chicago in 1887, the Union had grown to 372 divisions. At that convention, we found a new partner, the Grand International Auxiliary, which was formed by the wives of engineers who helped with the convention's arrangements. The GIA's assistance and charitable work have been invaluable over the years. Renamed the BLET Auxiliary in 2004, they continue to play an important role in advancing our struggles.
Finally, after half a century of unethical business practices, unregulated growth and bloodshed, the federal government passed legislation to rein in the industry, due in no small measure to the BLE's efforts. The 1893 Safety Appliance Act kicked off nearly a century of strict government regulation of the railroads. Air brake systems and automatic couplers were now required on all trains. These safety devices had been developed decades earlier, but were never installed because they cut into profits. But the engineer's job remained a hazardous one, as a tragic accident in 1900 underscored. An engineer named John Luther Jones, piloting the Cannonball Express, stayed at the throttle and sacrificed his life to save his passengers as the Cannonball plowed into a stalled freight in Mississippi. Overnight, Casey Jones became the nation's symbol of the bravery and dedication of locomotive engineers.
During the late 1800s through the first two decades of the 20th century, the railroads were unchallenged by any other form of transportation. At the turn of the century, nearly 200,000 miles of track crisscrossed the nation. It was a golden age for the railroads, but not for the railroad workers. Working conditions and pay were nowhere near what these workers deserved. Without skilled locomotive engineers, the railroads never could have responded to the demands of a country growing by leaps and bounds. But little was done to acknowledge the engineers' contributions.
As the railroad industry expanded, the Brotherhood was growing too. In 1900, it boasted nearly 34,000 members in 459 divisions. And in 1908, after having been based in Cleveland for nearly 40 years, the BLE chose the nation's sixth largest city as its permanent headquarters. Construction began on the 13-story Engineers Building, which opened in 1911, and the BLE erected the Standard Building across the street just over a decade later. The union also established its own BLE Cooperative Bank in Cleveland, anchoring a chain of cooperative banks around the country. 50 years after its creation, the Brotherhood had become a formidable American institution. And now, more powerful than ever, continued the struggle. In 1915, the BLE, along with other unions, pressed for an 8-hour workday in the railroad industry. When management rebuffed their demands, the workers found a powerful ally in President Wilson, who called on Congress to pass the landmark Adamson Act of 1916. The leader of the Brotherhood, Grand Chief Engineer Warren Stone, said that 1916 will go down in history as the most eventful year of the organization. We are making history so fast that it is almost impossible to keep up with or grasp it. Every day brings new developments, yet we believe in the end it will all work out to the advantage of every man who toils. Stone was right. With the world at war in 1917, a rail system capable of transporting large amounts of wartime goods and military personnel was needed. Short of resources, with a fragmented and outdated infrastructure, and many railroads in receivership, the industry was not up to the job. The government stepped in and nationalized the railroads. The infrastructure was streamlined and improved, and standardized wages and work rules were afforded to the engineers and workers in other crafts.
After the war, a heated debate erupted over the future of the industry. Rail labor, with the BLE in the lead, favored the Plum Plan, which would have bought out the private owners and maintained public operation under the supervision of a board composed equally of representatives of management, labor, and the public. Ultimately, though, the industry was returned to private ownership. But post-war America was a different country.
Airplanes and automobiles challenged trains for both cargo and passengers. Henry Ford's Model T was affordable for millions of Americans. And more Americans were taking to the roads, not the rails.
In the 20s, we fought hard to preserve what the Union won during nationalization. Congress passed the Railway Labor Act in 1926, and a new form of labor relations was born that still exists today. The law constrained the railroad workers' right to strike, but in exchange, they received federally funded arbitration of minor disputes that had led to strikes in the past. Under this new system, the BLE reached an agreement with 54 Eastern railroads that added almost $7 million to the wages of 30,000 members.
When the Great Depression struck in 1929, railroad after railroad sank into receivership. The BLE spearheaded the fight for pension and unemployment security, leading to the creation of the railroad retirement system. And the union, along with the rest of rail labor, won severance pay and other economic protection for workers who were harmed by rail mergers with the historic 1936 Washington Job Protection Agreement. Once more, the Brotherhood continued the struggle. Meanwhile, to compete with other passenger transportation, the railroads developed a new, improved passenger train during the 1930s. The Streamliner boasted luxury, style, comfort, and conveniences unlike anything ever seen on the railroads. While it boosted ridership for a brief period of time, in the long run, the Streamliner couldn't compete with the convenience of automobiles and the speed of airplanes. When global conflict broke out for a second time, the locomotive engineers carried their load and more in the fight for freedom. BLE members ran the trains that carried 90% of all military freight and 97% of all military personnel during World War II. Once again, railroads and the men who ran their trains played a major role in the Allied forces' success. But the jubilation of victory was followed by a period of long, steady decline for the railroad industry. The post-World War II era saw an explosion of federally funded competition against railroads. Air travel became practical thanks to the federal air traffic control system. The interstate highway system was built. Freight and passenger traffic plummeted, and railroads were again driven into bankruptcy or merger with mixed results. Now that World War II was over, the union had to redouble its struggle for the engineers.
After the war, the locomotive engineers were not on an equal footing with many other Americans. Wage and price controls had seriously eroded our standard of living, and the Brotherhood was determined to change that.
In 1946, the BLE and the Brotherhood of Railroad Trainmen went on strike. Trains across the country stopped running. Once again, the federal government stepped in. This time, however, the strike was ended on unfavorable terms. A meager pay increase.
Throughout the 50s and 60s, we fought for and won higher wages and railroad contributions to our health and welfare program. The BLE also created an apprentice engineer program, which gave aspiring engineers on-the-job training and assured them of a future in the industry. But those victories were offset by huge job losses caused by technology, like the diesel locomotive, which allowed a single engineer to operate multiple locomotives at once, and by taxpayer-supported competition in other transportation modes.
By the late 1960s, parts of the railroad industry flirted with extinction. A sea of red ink from passenger operations mandated by the federal government left railroads starved for cash, postponing track maintenance and creating a downward spiral. The 1970 bankruptcy of the Penn Central Railroad was the largest corporate failure in U.S. history. Several railroads faced total collapse and were in dire need of help. That help came in the form of government assistance. In 1970, Congress passed the Railroad Passenger Service Act, and Amtrak was born. 4 years later, the Regional Rail Reorganization Act led to the creation of Conrail from 7 bankrupt Northeast railroads, including the Penn Central. These new government-backed railroads launched a massive downsizing process, leading to the abandonment of thousands of miles of track and the elimination of tens of thousands of jobs. The BLE fought successfully to save many thousands more miles of track and saved thousands of engineers' jobs as well. But the bleeding continued as the Rock Island Railroad and the Milwaukee Road tumbled into bankruptcy in the mid-70s.
These laws created a new challenge for the BLE because a system that existed for a century was changing dramatically. The Brotherhood also had to fight to preserve and enhance safety because the government was considering eliminating locomotive inspections to reduce costs. We argued that fewer inspections would mean more accidents and increased injury and death to locomotive engineers.
This time, the government heard them. The 1980 Federal Railroad Safety Authorization Act provided for additional safety inspectors as well as safety research and development programs. Also that year, the landmark Staggers Rail Act deregulated the industry. Railroads raised rates and abandoned unprofitable trackage or sold it to short lines and regional railroads. Engineers lost jobs by the hundreds, or saw them replaced by much lower-paying non-union jobs. But the Brotherhood continued the struggle.
The landscape of the industry was changing fast, with a profound impact on BLE members. Huge mergers shrunk the number of major carriers to 7, and federal certification of locomotive engineers created a much higher standard of individual accountability. Because so many changes were being driven by the political process, the Brotherhood launched a political action committee, today called the BLET PAC, to help elect labor-friendly candidates and have more influence in the legislative process.
Deregulation allowed the railroads to lower their costs, and the industry experienced a renaissance. Profits and ton mileage increased, and freight ton miles today are more than double what they were in the mid-1940s. Because of clogged highways, skyrocketing gas prices, and thanks to safe and reliable service, Amtrak sets new ridership records almost every year. Shipping rates today are about half of what they were before deregulation, and hundreds of billions of dollars have been reinvested into infrastructure. Once again, the railroads haul more freight than any other mode of transportation. Technological improvements have brought faster, more environmentally friendly trains equipped with the latest electronics. For engineers, this means great opportunity and great challenge. The locomotive engineer of 1863 struggled to contain the power of but a single iron horse. The men and women behind the throttle of a freight train today often use distributed power locomotives, operating several different sets of locomotives located in multiple places within the train. Parts of the train going uphill and other parts going downhill at the same time. 2-mile-long monster trains powered by 6 or 8 locomotives have stretched current signal systems to their capacity, and the union is a leading advocate for the installation of positive train control, an advanced GPS-based train control system to supplement current signal and other main track authority systems. Are the Brotherhood and its members up to the challenges of the 21st century?
State-of-the-art traffic control systems, expanded commuter rail service, and high-speed passenger rail lines are all being planned, developed, and constructed. The railroad industry is as strong as ever, and the future looks bright. And the Brotherhood is blessed with an incredible record of success to guide our work in the future as we meet the challenges of tomorrow.
Through it all, the Brotherhood has continued the struggle. In 2004, the BLE merged with the International Brotherhood of Teamsters and became the Brotherhood of Locomotive Engineers and Trainmen. Today, the BLET represents over 55,000 locomotive engineers and trainmen throughout the United States.
Railroads are as vital to America as ever, and the need for a union that struggles to improve wages and working conditions for locomotive engineers and trainmen is as urgent today as it was in 1863. This brotherhood will continue the struggle. We will continue to fight for better wages, improved benefits, and safer working conditions for BLET members, for Teamsters Rail Conference members, for railroad workers, for all union members, and for the American middle class. As a locomotive engineer, I can tell you that there's never been a life quite like ours. Today, the Brotherhood of Locomotive Engineers and Trainmen celebrates a proud tradition, as individual members and as a union, that has been 150 years in the making. And I thank you for celebrating our heritage with us.
Funding for this national BLET educational presentation has been provided by the North American Railway Foundation. NARF is a nonprofit operating foundation that was formed and funded by the Brotherhood's Relief and Compensation Fund to support rail history, education, safety, and technology in the United States and Canada. With continued Board of Directors stewardship coming from the BR and CF, NARF has supported many worthwhile projects over its 16-year history. The primary focus of these efforts has been in support of organized rail labor, giving back to all of the men and women of the railroad community across North America.